working toward a solution that's much better than what we're using right now, so please be patient with us. You'll notice, hopefully, that you can hear a little better in here this morning. Peter, thanks to Peter, he fixed our main speakers, and so they're working a lot better. You should be able to hear a lot better this morning. Now, Steve Bates, he's going to come and share an announcement about Lighthouse.
Good morning. Summit Heights has always been very gracious and helpful to Lighthouse Academy in Newburgh. It's an after-school program, and it's a ministry of the Heartland District and the United Methodist Church, but Summit Heights has always been very supportive. We have a back-to-school fair, but this year it's a backpack distribution drive-up on August 1st. We have lots of backpacks, but we do not have school supplies. And by the way, Jefferson County Public Schools is probably going to have to eliminate a lot of their backpack distributions because of the COVID, so there'll be a lot more people needing school supplies this year if and when school starts. But a lot of kids in need, a lot of families financially in need, and this will greatly benefit them. We have the backpacks are here. They'll be outside this door that's open after the service. There's a cardboard box there. Just pick up one or two backpacks, everything you can do. The list of the school supplies that are needed, depending on that age group student, is on the backpack. All you have to do is fill the backpack and bring it back. You can bring it back next Saturday, next Sunday, or for sure by July 26th, and I'll collect those and I'll give them back to Lighthouse so we can have them for August 1st to give up. The families will drive up. We'll hand them, how many students are in the car? We'll hand them a full backpack full of school supplies for every student that's in there. So thank you for your support. Thank you for your help.
Thank you, Steve. Let's pray together. Gracious and loving God, you're an almighty God and a good God, and you know everything about us. We're an open book. So Lord, we pray that you would be present to us in the person and power of your Holy Spirit this morning as we worship you, that we would worship you in a worthy manner, and that we would perfectly love you with our whole hearts, our whole minds, our whole souls, and all of our strength. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
All right, that's it for a while. Stand up, please.
Wonder grace of Jesus.
Teach us to love you with our whole being and to love our neighbors as ourselves. We pray for our church, or for the people of God called Summit Heights United Methodist Church. Give us clarity of focus and dedication to your purpose. Lord, enable us to love one another so that our love is a witness to the world. Give us grace to know that your love is enough, and that we can, in the power of your Spirit, be the church, the people you're calling us to be. Lord, for those in our world, in our families, in our church family who are hurting, who are struggling with illness, and pain and suffering, we pray for healing. We pray for your healing touch. Lord, for our society that's feeling broken, that's, Lord, somehow lost its way, help us to do our part to foster mutual respect and peace. For our world, Lord, we pray for healing from this pandemic. We pray that your Spirit would sweep across this globe and bring wholeness. All these things, Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And also when they say God is what it means we want to show His love to all kinds of people. We can show our love going out of our way to help others. So in other words, kids out there, you know, if you're over a friend's house and you're playing a video game or shooting some basketball or something, and all of a sudden our mom says, you know, where are your earpods? Where's your other shoe? You might need to hit pause and quit shooting basketball and go help your friend find the stuff. And that's a good way to help a friend. And I'm sure my sons are liking that example. So pray with me. Dear Lord, even though the children aren't up here and they might be watching the video, please be with them as they finish out the summer and hopefully go back to school. If not, be with them in whatever way they need help with, and help them continue to grow in your name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Chair. Now, friends, this is the normal time to take up our offering, but we're going to be passing the place today. We won't be passing the place for quite some time until we get into what's called Phase 3, which is nowhere near ready for Phase 3. So, just like you did last week, those of you who are here, if you brought an offering, thank you so much. There are offering plates in the narthex when you leave this morning. You can also continue to give by mailing to the church you're giving. Also, there's an online option, so those of you who are on Facebook Live with us this morning, there's a link in the video description where you can go to our website and find ways to give online as well. Thank you so much for your faithfulness in giving and supporting the mission of God through the ministry of Summit Heights United Methodist Church.
Thanks be to God. Lord.
Now, that would be a challenging enough experience because we camped out too tents, our food, our camp stove, and carry up an 8-foot bank on the side of the river that is flooded. And watching these young people with our two counselors do all that work and then carry all their gear hundreds of yards down below the dam where we were able to camp it up that night. The experience of overcoming adversity, overcoming this tremendous obstacle, really brought this team together, unified this team. And at the end of the week, it was amazing to see how the Lord used that experience to draw us closer to one another and closer to Him. Now, I'm sure that you've had many team experiences. Some teams are more focused than others. Some teams are more unified than others. Some teams are more dedicated to their purpose than others. But the church is like a team. And one of the early symbols of the church has been a ship or a boat, as if the boat is carrying us, or the ship is carrying us through rough seas to get us to our goal, which is the fullness of the kingdom of God. And in that sense, we're all in the same boat. We're all in the same ship, all moving towards the same goal. That's what I'm talking about during this series called Calling: Principles, Priorities, and Purposes. Sharing with you as a pastor what I believe God's calling is and what it looks like when it's lived out in the context of the family of faith of the church, of all of us in this one church, one boat, moving in the right direction. Now, a central component of Paul's message to the Ephesians that we see here in Ephesians 4 that Dudley read for us a moment ago is the idea of unity. It's one of his most important messages in all of his letters, but it particularly comes to the surface here in this amazing letter to the Ephesians. And I just want to highlight a couple of these verses. So Ephesians 4, 1 and 3 says, "I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace." Now, Paul's not making a suggestion here. He's not saying, "Hey, if you don't have anything better to do, why don't y'all learn how to get along?" No, he's urging us, he's exhorting us, he's strongly encouraging us. This concept of unity is central to the life of the church. And he says, walk. Walk in a way that's worthy. The walk is not like how you walk, like literally your steps. It talks about your way of living, your way of being in the world. As followers of Jesus, Paul is saying, your life should reflect the reality of the calling that you have and the character of the one who is calling you. He says, walk in a way that's worthy to be in alignment with so that your life reflects the one who is calling you. And then we talked last week about calling, that we're all called, and that's the topic of our series is calling. And then we talked about the universal calling, that every single person that's alive on planet Earth is called to be a disciple, a follower of Jesus. And then that specific call that as we become followers of Jesus, as we grow as followers of Jesus, that we are all called to serve. We're all called to serve the mission of God, not build our own little kingdoms, but build for God's kingdom. And then Paul says, as you walk in this way that's worthy of your calling, you're going to want to be eager, to be earnest, put some effort into it, put a little elbow grease into this idea of unity. Because unity takes work. Unity doesn't happen automatically. Because when you get more than one person together, you have the potential for conflict. And conflict happens in every relationship. Conflict happens in every community. It's inevitable because we're different people and we have different perspectives and we come at it with different gifts and graces. But Paul says that because that's true, that we have to put some effort, put some elbow grease into working to maintain unity, the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Unity is vital in the church. We're all in the same boat, so to speak. You know, one of the reasons why a boat or a ship became a symbol for the church is some biblical ideas, some biblical stories like Noah's Ark. And in disciples and Jesus were hanging out in a boat on the Sea of Galilee. There's that famous story where the storm was rocking the boat and the disciples were afraid for their lives. And sometimes we feel like that in the church. Lord, where are you? What's going on? And, you know, he's asleep. He's calm. He's relaxed. He's not worried about anything because God doesn't get worried. He doesn't have anxiety like we do. And yet he spoke peace. He spoke out of that place of non-anxiety. He spoke peace into the storm, and he calmed the storm. And he wants to calm the storm in our lives today. Unity takes effort. It takes work. It's not automatic. It's not something. It is something that every one of us has to put some work towards. We have to put some effort into it. So when you're rowing the boat, you're not rocking. When you're busy rowing, when you've got the paddle in your hand or the oars in your hand, and you're busy moving the boat towards its goal, you're going to be a lot less likely to sow seeds of disunity and disharmony and broken relationships. You're going to be we'll be working together. When you're rowing the boat, you're not rocking the boat. When you row the boat, instead of rocking the boat, you want to focus on the mission of God. Because that's what it's all about. We want to focus on the goal of where we're going, the purpose, the mission of the team. You know, sports teams get into trouble a lot of times when individual players on the team, and even sometimes individual coaches on the team, begin to work for their own glory and their own recognition instead of the success of the team. And that causes all kinds of rocking of the boat. But if the individuals of the team are focused on the goal, which if you're on a team, a sports team, the goal would be to win, maybe win a championship, what have you, then you're going to be less likely to worry about the applause you're getting and more interested in is the team being successful. In the church, when we get distracted by individual preferences and desires, and sometimes we forget that we're called to be the family of God, serving the mission of God, making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. If we're focused like a laser beam on our mission, on our goal, if we're rowing the boat together, we're not going to be rocking the boat. It's important as we move forward that you're serving God's purpose. And when you're serving God's purpose, seeking unity, you need to remember that unity and uniformity are not the same. Unity is not uniformity. When you're rowing, you're not worried about uniformity, you're worried about unity. Matter of fact, Paul wrote in Ephesians, the last verse that I read for us, but grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. So what that tells us is that God deals with us as individuals, that he's blessed us as individuals, he's gifted us as individuals, he's not given everyone the same measure of his giftings, we don't all have the same talents, we don't all have the same strengths, we're each individual treated as an individual, and God is the one who does the measuring, God's the one who does the giving, it's not like a cafeteria thing where you go through and say, well, Lord, I want this gift, and I want that gift, and that's no good. I like this one. That's not how God works. God decides. He decides what gifts we receive. And then we have to decide whether or not we'll use our gifts. And we recognize that other people in the church have different giftings than we do. We're not uniform. We're not just clones of one person. We're different individuals, but we're in the same boat. We're headed to the same destiny. We're headed to the same shore. We're working towards the same goal. We're furthering the same purpose and the same mission. So as you're rowing, you want to remember that you're on a team with different kinds of people, different perspectives, but you're serving the same purpose. I really like this quote from John Wesley. He's actually quoting the Old Testament, but he says, it's a famous quote from his sermon, Catholic Spirit. If your heart is as my heart, give me your hand. And he's talking about opinions, different opinions that we might have about different things, of different points of theology or different ways of understanding He wasn't talking about the basics like the resurrection of Jesus or the things that were in the Apostles' Creed. He's talking about opinions, the modes of baptism, things like this. He's saying, if your heart is right, if your heart is right with the Lord, as my heart is right with the Lord, then give me your hand. We can work together. So your gifts, they were chosen for you. You don't get to choose them. You have the same. You have your talents and strengths, and God treats this unique individual who's called to be united in one family with other followers of Jesus. Unity is important. And also, unity is a witness. The unity of a church is a witness to those around the church, in the neighborhood, in your workplace, those who might come here for a special event, those who might interact with the church in any way, shape, or form, those who might hear you, overhear you talking about your church when you're out and about, when you're in your workplace, when you're in your neighborhood, when you're with your social networks. The unity of the church is a witness. It's a witness to those who have yet to get on board, those who have yet to get into the boat. Jesus said this to his disciples, "This is how everyone will know that you are my disciples, when you love each other." So our love for each other actually is a witness. It's a blessing to one another, but it's a witness to those who are out there in the world. Let's think about this. You know, we talk about unity without uniformity. Well, look at the group of people that Jesus is talking to. He's got these 12 individuals that come from all kinds of different backgrounds. I just want to focus just on two real quick. One was Simon the Zealot. Another was named Levi, or Matthew, and he was a tax collector. And these two guys somehow figured out a way to hang out together and not kill each other for a period of at least 3 years. Now, that might not seem as shocking to you, but let me help you wrap your mind around the reality of how shocking that is. Simon was called a zealot. A zealot were those people, those Jews, who were considered at the time radical Jewish nationalists. They were bordering on what we would call terrorists today. They were actually engaged in what we would consider guerrilla warfare against the Roman and the Roman oppressors. They hated the Romans, and they hated anyone who would cooperate with the Romans. And that's exactly who Matthew was. He was a tax collector. He was a Jew who was working with and for the Roman Empire, enabling and empowering their continued oppression of the Jewish people. That's natural in the world's way of thinking that these two guys would have hated each other, even to the point of violence. But love, the love of the Messiah, the love of Jesus, brings all kinds of people together into one tribe, one body, one team, one family, the family of faith, the people of God. And the love of God penetrates all division, creating unity of heart and mind. This kind of love is a powerful witness to the world that's being torn apart today by division and hatred, tribalism, intersectionality, racism, and political polarization. The unity of the church is a witness to the world. And one of the ways we protect the unity of the church is by rowing the boat. Because if you're busy rowing, you're not going to be rocking. Unity is also a reflection of God's character. It's a reflection of godliness. Church unity is based on the unity of God Himself. God's nature and God's character is that God is one. He has been revealed to us as a holy Trinity. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Three persons united into one God. One God. Talks about this here in our reading. There's one body, one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. The oneness of God, the oneness of our baptism, the oneness of our faith, the oneness of the Spirit calls us to a oneness and a unity as a family of God, as a church. Now this letter that Paul wrote, that we call Ephesians, was written to several churches. lordship of our lives as individuals and as the church. In all, through the mystery of the Holy Spirit, and the Bible says the Holy Spirit comes and takes up his residence inside of us as individuals, but also in the body. And then through, we are called to be channels of God's grace, of God's love, of God's hope, of God's peace to a world that desperately needs healing and forgiveness and unity. Salvation really is about joining the team, submitting to the Lordship of Jesus, yielding to God's leadership in our lives. At that canoe camp in 2007, one of the most amazing things that I discovered or that I experienced was that those kids were put in a situation and circumstances where it was to their great benefit if they would learn how to trust me as their leader. Because I'd been there before. I had lots of experience canoeing and camping and all that stuff. As they were learning to trust my leadership on the river, it wasn't just automatic. They had to actually kind of yield to that. But as they learned to do that, they were also learning to trust my leadership and what I was teaching them about Jesus Christ and his love for them. Every team has a coach. Every boat has a captain. And in life, there is one coach. There's one captain. There's one Lord and King. He's not you, and he's not me. His name is Jesus, and he laid down his life for us to forgive us of our sins and free us to live in the liberty of his love. Let's get on board and row together. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we acknowledge that you are Lord and King. You are our coach, our boss. You are our CEO, our manager, our team leader. And you call each one of us to be a part of this team. The team called Summit Heights United Methodist Church. We're thankful for the ways that you have moved in our hearts and in our lives to bring us to this point together. Look forward to what you're going to do in our midst and through us in the days and months and in the years ahead. Lord, mold us, fashion us, help us to do that hard work, put that elbow grease.
like the part-time secretarial position. It's trainable with Microsoft Word, QuickBooks, things of that sort. Please get them to someone on the SPRC committee and we'll get them the things that we're looking for and we can see about their application. If you all have any questions, please contact SPRC members. Thank you.
Thank you, Anissa. I just want to say thank you to Anissa and the rest of the SPR. And just be in prayer for them and be in prayer that for our church that we find that person is that right fit that's going to be helping us with that mission of growing forward, moving forward, and growing for God's kingdom. Now you receive a blessing from our God. Go forth in peace. And may the God who calls us through his Son Jesus Christ pour out his Holy Spirit so that we can be